Welcome to Nonbait Alpha. I'm Ryan Morphin. On today's episode, we have Admiral Scott Sanders, founder of Tobacco Barn Distillery, talking to us about the history of Maryland bourbon and the unusual ways to distill it. This is Nonbait Alpha. Admiral, welcome to the show. Thank you for joining us, sir.
Good to be here, Ryan. Thanks for having me on.
So you've had a storied career in the Navy, and you've recently got involved with a liquor distillery company based in Maryland. Could you talk to us a little bit about, you know, Tobacco Barn and what you guys do over there and what your social, you know, impact double bottom line approach is?
Yeah, thanks, Ryan, for asking. Well, I'm not involved with it. We started. I have two partners. We're a veteran-owned small business, so I'm a Navy guy. One partner is Marine, and one partner is not military. But anyways, it started. I can go into that a little bit later on. But we started the business about 2014 after a couple of years of looking at the industry, writing a business plan, seeing how the laws were changing. So we actually grow the corn we make our bourbon out of, and so it's turned out to be a really good product.
So how many acres of corn do you guys have, and how much does it take to make one bottle of bourbon?
Yeah, I don't know by the bottle, but we need about 8 acres of corn a year to, and that's at a average yield. I mean, every, you know, as a farmer, your yield goes up and down, and our yield this year was really good. But it's about a 20 and a half acre farm. And with corn, you have to rotate. So 1 year it's soybean. We do about 2/3 soybeans and 1/3 corn. And that just keeps moving.
And is there a particular type of corn that's good and well-suited for bourbon?
Everybody tries their own, you know, whatever in your local area is. We just use a regular field corn. So it's as I tell people, it's a commodity grain here. So corn and soybeans, if you have a 20-acre farm in Maryland, all you're doing is going broke slowly because you can barely pay the taxes. So that's why we got into value-added agriculture, taking the corn, making bourbon, because if not, it'll be a housing development at 2 years, the farm.
So what's anything specific about Tobacco Barn as a brand? How did you guys come up with the name?
Well, because we're a former tobacco farm, and we have, if you... on the bottle behind me here, that's our bottle that has a, it's about an 1830s tobacco barn that's on the property. The farm's been in tillage for a couple hundred years. And it's now we it's been growing, it was growing tobacco until the 1990s. Now it's corn and soybeans. So that's where we got it from. And tobacco is the heritage of Maryland, colonial Maryland and Virginia. Everybody grew tobacco because that was the money.
Got it. And so as you guys are looking at this value add agriculture strategy, what about bourbon or the bourbon market was intriguing to you guys?
Well, there's an upside and a downside. It takes a long time, but then also all the indicators, if you go back to 2012, when we were looking at this, the market was on an upswing and the capacity, just what they're, even the big boys were building capacity, as well as the craft industry was just starting to get its sea legs, to use a Navy term. And it started formulating. And now there's over 2,000 craft distilleries in the U.S.
And some of the famous ones like Tito's have taken off. You know, how do you guys look? You know, so maybe we can talk about the manufacturing process for you guys. And what does it look like? Is it all American made bottles and such? What's your approach to producing the product?
Yeah, we source everything locally. I mean, we grow the corn. We get the rye from a Mennonite farm about 12 miles away. One brother we get the rye from, the other brother has the grist mill in the county. So all the grains, all the processing goes in locally. We're small batch, and small batch doesn't really have a term. It's like saying a natural food product. There's no legal foundation for that. So we just make it one batch at a time, though. So it's kind of a pot still approach, even though it's not a pot still, as opposed to the large manufacturers that will do, they use a continuous distillation column. And the way they take their quote cuts is they take it off the levels on the column, where we do a batch at a time, and we take heads and we take the heads and the tails out. So we only put about the hearts cut on the second distillation. So we distill it twice. And the second one, we only take about 60% of that. What's in the middle, we call it the heart. Everybody calls it the heart's cut. That's what we actually put in the barrel.
Got it. And so I'm assuming you're outsourcing all the production, right? The small batch to a regional distiller, or do you guys have all your own machinery for that?
No, Ryan, we're just not that smart. We actually grow the corn. So we're the farmers and the distillers. Everything's done on site. So,
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So we cook it, we mash it, we distill it, we barrel it, we age it, and we bottle it all on the farm. Yeah. This is homespun.
So this is a labor of love. How do you guys find, you know, the barrels, and how do you differentiate your flavor, or how do you guys, who's the kind of the taster of your bourbon?
Yeah. Well, two different things. So on the barrels, it's actually a kind of a hard thing for a new startup distillery for craft people, because no supplier of barrels wants to sell you three and then wait 3 months and sell you three more. And in the United States, you can make personal beer, personal wine. You can make zero personal alcohol. So it's expensive to get in, and you don't know if it's going to taste good. So we all start off with doing small barrels. We start off in 5-gallon barrels. Up in New York, you probably know, you might have had Hudson, Baby Hudson bourbon up there. Yep. It's in a small barrel, because you get it in a small barrel, it doesn't age quicker. What it does is pulls the flavors out of the wood quicker, because there's more surface area per, you know, volume of bourbon in there too. So, We did that. We did a first run of 14 5-gallon barrels, and that got us in Whiskey Advocate. I don't know how the hell that happened, but, you know, we got in there. So so we knew our mash bill was right, and that gets to the second part of your question. Our mash bill, we're high in rye content, so about 23% rye. And we do that because there wasn't bourbon back then, but the precursors of bourbon were kind of being made in Maryland in the 1700s. So if you've ever seen an old granddad bottle, that's a caricature of a guy named Basil Hayden. And he was born about 12 miles from our farm. And so Basil Hayden, they had corn and they had rye back then, because rye is a winter crop. You grow it in the winter. And if you had a cleared field in the summer, you were growing tobacco in Maryland. You weren't growing wheat and barley. So that was kind of their mash bill. He ended up taking 25 families after the Revolutionary War, about 1786. He got overland to Pittsburgh on a flatboat down the Ohio River, and he got a land patent in the far reaches of Virginia. His land patent was signed by Governor Patrick Henry of Virginia, a place called Pottinger's Creek. And that today is about 20 miles south of Bardstown, Kentucky. So that's how Maryland screwed the pooch on bourbon. They all left. In Kentucky, they make awesome bourbon. I do a lot of industry survey. My wife calls it drinking, but they put bourbon at the front. I thank Kentucky for doing what they've done with bourbon. But according to the Chamber of Commerce in Kentucky, the world started in 1792 and it didn't. So there were people. Basil Hayden did not learn how to distill on the flatboat from Pittsburgh to the Falls of the Ohio.
Well, that is interesting. I didn't know that. So now, would you say bourbon or this all started in like the Maryland kind of Chesapeake area, or does it have its precursor dates to somewhere in Europe for this type of mixture?
It all goes to the English Reformation, Ryan. So just the first time distillation of something from a grain into alcohol is actually pretty recent in world history, a little bit about 500 years ago. So in late 1490s, It was written down. Somebody ordered that. The King of England ordered this stuff called Whiskey Bay from some Scottish guy. And so, and that's how we get the term whiskey. It's some Gaelic term that means water of life, eau de vie. Every culture has this. And so, and then you go forward a little bit, 40 or 50 years, that's when Henry VIII, he took over all the Catholic property in England. And so at that point, all those priests, friars, and monks and bishops were now out of a job, but they knew how to distill because they were making brandy and other things at the time. So then go forward another 60 years, the first distillery on planet Earth opens up in, you know, Ireland at the beginning of the 1600s. So it's, there's a little, the Catholicism is tied in here. So Maryland, it wasn't a colony at first. It was a business enterprise. Same thing with Virginia. Maryland, just because it was Catholic, the Catholic distillers came to Maryland. So on this side, north of the Potomac, you got distillers. South of the Potomac, not as much or a few. There was a guy there who was making, I think, George Thorpe, I think, 1620, 1621. He was making corn beer. I'll give him the credit for distilling. Anyways, he didn't survive the first Powhatan War, so we'll never know. No. And then, you know, distilling really didn't show up in Virginia again on a big scale until George Washington after a revolution.
And so is it right to assume that the founding fathers were partaking in some good bourbon?
Oh, hell yeah. Well, I wouldn't.
There we go.
Oh, bourbon. It was, you know, back then they didn't age it stuff. I mean, it was nasty. They weren't.
Yeah.
You know, they were drinking
little
because
gruff.
The water was so bad.
It was better than water, I assume. I still feel that way. I like your term industry surveys. I'll be using that on the home front as well. So
they'll believe it the first or the second time.
So now that you guys, you know, you're up and running, what's your marketing strategy? What's your go-to-market like, and how are you guys positioned in the marketplace today with your brand?
Well, we're a very small right now, but we've started 6 years ago, and so we have probably 92% of everything we've made is still aged, and that's a picture of the Rick House behind me. But we haven't really released much, but we have started to release a little bit more. And so right now we have a couple of good partners. In Maryland, we have in the Southern area, we have some good stores we work with. And then Total Wine has been a really good partner. They've been helped us out quite a bit here too. So we're starting to get things out. And then we go to some niche markets because we're, if you like the rye forward piece, it works out pretty well. Some people like the spiciness of rye, others don't. That's okay. It's just whatever people like, you know, it's whatever flavor you're looking for.
And are you guys doing a distributor model, or are you trying to go build a base of grassroots support? Like, how are you guys getting into either store shelves or bars or consumers?
Right now we had a distributor a couple of years ago, but we were too small. I mean, we weren't ready for that and it didn't work out. It wasn't their fault. It wasn't our fault. It just, you know, just the way it is. It was a good experience to go through. It's like your first girlfriend. Hey, that wasn't going to work out, but you know, she didn't like me either. And so so we're just kind of figuring this thing out. We got to see where we're going to go in a couple years. We're going to be a regional enough to go regionally. And so we're looking at those options right now, and we do have to see how we would get to distribution.
And as you scale up, are you going to have to buy more acreage for more corn, do you think?
No, we got plenty of acreage because, we know the people next door, you know, it's farmland. So we can get to other people we need to get to.
Got it. Well, and so you guys also do a lot of what we'll call social double bottom line type of marketing strategies. Can you talk to us a little bit about the history of the USS Constellation and what you guys are doing on the boat?
Yeah, so when I first started out, you know, bourbon takes a while. Rum, you can get to market a little bit quicker. And so we did, I convinced my partners in a weak moment to make a little rum, because I'm the Navy guy, and found out we could get molasses made in Maryland. Maryland makes, I don't know, 10 or 11% of the nation's molasses supply, because we still have it's a byproduct of making sugar. And we still have a large domino factory in Baltimore. So it's great. So we get the highest quality molasses on the planet. We distill that, age it and use bourbon barrels. And then we load it aboard the USS Constellation. It's the not the original, you know, 1794 Constellation. It's the 1854 one. It's a it's the last all sail warship of the U.S. Navy. So it, I mean, it's 1854. There's no electricity or hydraulics. You're twisting the yard arm 45 degrees and 10 guys on the capstan. I mean, it's kind of cool, but it's a little wacky too. And we can only fit four barrels. So we do that. In fact, here's a bottle here. So yeah, let me do this here. Oop. I'm gonna have to take this thing off here. Take this virtual background thing off so you can see it. So the what it is just this you know, there's the USS Constellation rum on there. So
very cool.
You do that, you get everybody, you know, and everyone, you know, it's individually numbered and all that, and then we donate proceeds back to the ship on it. So, and that works.
Very cool.
And so as you guys are growing your I guess your bourbon, now you've got a rum. Is the rum brand on the same? Is it Tobacco Barn Rum?
Yeah, it's the same, but we don't make rum. So I mean, all we do is we make USS Constellation, as long as I keep tricking my partners to make a little bit. So we do that. The proceeds go to the Constellation. So we're a bourbon house and whiskey. So we do that because we donate to veterans causes, maritime causes, and those type of things.
No, that's fascinating. So the ship and the movement of the waves and the buoyancy of the ship, that helps push the rum around to get the flavor from the casks. Is that right?
Yeah, it's you know, it's not marketing. It's not a gimmick. It's fact. It's science. So what happened, if you might have heard of Jefferson's Ocean Bourbon, it's the same process. They put barrels on a ship. They have to go out. Sure, we're the only one who has a license in the United States to age in U.S. waters on a ship. I think some people do it on boats, but we're the only one on a ship. So it because inside 12 nautical miles, you have to do it that way. Anyways, it moves around, so you get a lot more barrel action. And then during a nor'easter or a storm, you get a lot of good oxidation in there. And it just, it mellows it out, just gives it a good flavor.
So have you always drank bourbon, or is this something that, you know, every few years my palate changes, I guess, but is it something that you've always been an aficionado over, or is this something that's new?
No, I was more of a Scotch guy. You know, this in the beginnings of this, my two partners, I've known them for a long time. I was in the Navy. We were Scotch, and I'll say a lot. We were just getting into bourbon. This is 12, 13 years ago. And then I went off. I was in the Navy. I did this. I ran the International Counter-Piracy Force off of Somalia for 6 months. That was the best and the absolute worst job I ever did. But I found out when I was meeting with other, I've been on Chinese ships, Russian, all the European navies, Korea, you know, everybody. I do a lot of engagements. And the U.S. Navy is kind of cheap. So I really had no gifts to give out. And so what I would have to do is I pulled into port and I got three cases of bourbon, American bourbon. And I got one of those little gold Sharpies and I would sign it to whoever, Admiral, whatever. You know, thanks for your fight and piracy with me. Love and kisses. Enjoy the bottle, Admiral Sanders. So then tell people I was the most popular date in the Gulf of Aden for 6 months. Because even if they didn't really want to see me again, they wanted another bottle of bourbon. So after I got back, I'm relaying this story to my buddies while we're drinking. And I said, hey, bourbon, it's, you know, it's got worldwide. You know, I didn't realize. I said, I know in the U.S. we like it, but worldwide, I mean, everybody, the Russians, the Chinese, all the Europeans, the Koreans, everybody's drinking this stuff. And so my one friend goes, well, I had the number three license to distill corn into ethanol during the fuel crisis for farm tractors. So he knew the process. And so one thing led to another. again, we put a business plan together. That was about 2010. And then we started the business in 2014.
Since you're, you know, a retired admiral, how is the Navy doing? Is the size of the Navy at the right, you know, scale, or do we need more ships? And what are your thoughts about the Chinese maritime ambitions in the South China Sea? Lots to unpack there.
Yeah. I will deflect that to somebody who's much more informed on the current status of their, I'll stick to bourbon on this call here. There's, you know, a lot of people have opinions on force structure and what's going on out in the South China Sea. There's obviously a lot of concerns there, but there's a lot more informed people than me just to be spouting opinions.
Got it. So you guys are also looking at doing, I guess, taking some bourbon on a Harrier. Can you talk to us a little bit about that?
Yeah, that's the coolest thing we're going to do yet to date. So we always like that. That's kind of our brand, is we like doing innovative things like on the ship. And then what we're, I have a friend who owns a Harrier jet. So he and I were, he came to me to buy some bourbon one time, because after he flies people around in his other jet he has, he gives him a bottle of bourbon. So, and then we just started talking. We said, hey, why don't we fly some bourbon barrels on your Harrier? And we figured out how to do it. So what we're going to do is, he has a Harrier jet. He gave me two of his used fuel tanks. We've cored those out. We're going to put 225-gallon barrels from Kelvin Barrels in Louisville. We have bourbon for them, and we're going to fly them 700 miles an hour. So the speed isn't going to – that's not what's going to do it. But we'll get up to about 15,000 feet, and we will. What that'll do, if you, you know, whatever class you take, you learn this stuff. You know, at sea level, it's 14.7 pounds per square inch. 15,000 feet, there's some lapse rate. It'll be about 6-point-something psi up there. So, bottom line, it's going to expand. So, I don't know if those barrels are going to explode or what, but that bourbon's going all in the wood. And it's going to change the flavor. Plus the fact the temperature is going to drop quite a bit. You lose about 2 degrees Celsius per 1,000 feet. So it's going to drop on down. All of that, plus the speed, plus the jostling around, plus being on a Harrier jet, is going to do something to it. I got interviewed about it. They said, what is it going to do? I said, I have no idea. It's never been done before. That's kind of cool.
So how does one buy a Harrier, and where do you park it? And, how do you acquire such a toy?
There's a market and a marketplace for these things. Thankfully, my buddy bought one, and he's a Marine, because it's a, and we're doing this for what's called Semper Fi Fund. So that's the best veterans charity around. They do awesome work for families of disabled and injured veterans. And that's what this is all about. So we're only going to get about 600 bottles. It's only 100 gallons, but it's going to be the most awesome bourbon around.
Fantastic.
I was going to mention something else we do, getting in the creativity game. I know you did a podcast on New York real estate a few months ago. So
I did, yep.
My daughter was one of the young couples that ended up leaving Brooklyn, and they moved up to Westchester County. And she's pregnant, they're changing, they're doing all this stuff all at one time. I don't understand why she wanted this much stress, but they did. And so they moved in August. They were looking for a place. You know, there's 3, 4, 5 different offers. And so I said, Sarah, do you think the guy likes whiskey or bourbon? She goes, yeah, I think he does. I saw a bottle. I said, tell him I'll throw in a 5-gallon personal barrel of bourbon. So bourbon sealed the deal on that New York real estate transaction.
Well, that's awesome. And I will tell you, it is a very competitive market in the suburbs of New Jersey, New York, Connecticut. So that definitely differentiated the bid, I'm sure. That's awesome. Well,
Maryland to pick it up, because I can't deliver it to him. He'll get 5 gallons of bourbon out of it.
Well, you know what? I'm sure getting a tour, that's definitely worth the trip. How far are you guys from DC or from Baltimore?
We're only about an hour. We're about an hour south of DC and about an hour and a half south of Baltimore.
Got it. When will the bourbon that you guys started to prepare, when do you think that comes of age, ready for prime time?
The bourbon we have for what?
Well, you said you have a bunch of bourbon that's still in the barrels. How long does it typically, do you typically age it?
Right now we're doing it. It's in a 30 gallon barrel and it's 3 years. So we're releasing 3 year bourbon right now. And,
got it.
And that's what we have coming out now. And we released, I'll say 420 cases last year. And then in August, we upped that. We're going to about 980 cases this year. The good news is we sell every bottle we make. The bad news is we just don't release that much because our best taste tester is actually my partner's wife, Susie. She is, you know, there's certain God gifts. It's like an athlete. You either have the stuff or you don't. She has the full package of all those sensory things. And boy, she knows good bourbon.
Sounds like a fun person to hang out with. Must schedule a time to come visit and hang out with you guys. Well, on this second season, we're asking all the folks that come on the show for kind of six questions at the end, just to kind of get a survey from around the country. And they're usually yes or no questions. And if you want to put some context in the back of them, that'd be great. But here we go. First question is, if there was a COVID vaccine available today, would you take it?
Yes.
Who do you think wins the election in November?
I have no clue.
Yeah, that's a tough one. It's really a tough one right now. What type of economic recovery are we in? What shape is this recovery taking?
It's marbled. It's good in some areas. It's horrible in some areas. And it's, you know, some people are treading water in others. So it depends on where you are. I mean, for example, we have a tasting room. I mean, we're getting decimated. We lost 90% of our retail business during COVID because people can't go up. You know, we're clawing a little bit back here, but we lost a lot of business. Now our wholesale, you know, going to it, they got hit, but not as bad.
Is there anything that you've achieved this summer that you're particularly proud of since we've been on lockdown? Any special new hobbies or projects you've taken on?
Yeah, the fact that I worked through two federal bureaucracies, alcohol, tobacco, and then the FAA to get this 700-mile-an-hour bourbon flight going. That's amazing. One federal bureaucracy is maddening enough. If you can work through two of them, that's amazing.
That's a good day's work. When is the Harrier taking off?
Right now we're planned for April of 2021. And we're you know, right now it's a fundraiser, so we want to have people attend. And it's all for Semper Fi Fund again. And so if we're hoping, you know, if we get a vaccine or COVID, Maryland's doing pretty good, but, you know, we're not there yet where you can have people around or that many. So we're hoping in April.
Are there any silver linings that you see in the economy in 2021?
Oh yeah, it caused you to be innovative. I mean, it's thrown, you know, the box got jumbled up and you gotta start thinking. And so, hey, what do we do now? What's different? How can we adjust? So I know some of the people have probably listened to your podcast here, Ryan. So I have I got a lot of wealth management people. I'm now doing Zoom tastings for their clients because, hey, it's something they can do. They can stay connected with their client. It's kind of cool. It's what, you know, so what we do. So I work out we work out a process so I can do Zoom tastings with them. So when you get to the type of people you have when you're running a wealth management company, that's kind of a nice thing to do.
No, absolutely. Is there anything that you're watching right now or listening to or reading that's kind of impacting your thinking through this pandemic?
Yeah, I don't know if you know this guy named Zion. He's kind of a strategy guy. He tries to stay apolitical, but I tell you what, I think he's the way he looks at the world in the future as far as how we're set, I think is very interesting. Having been in the Mideast for a while, I'm glad we're kind of weaned off our need for fossil fuels from over there. And he actually has getting to the elite. He didn't think it matters who wins. He thinks we're on a pretty good direct trajectory. And I'm in that camp too.
Yeah, I think there's a lot to be proud of how this country's handled, you know, COVID. There's still a lot to be desired. Data, quality of the data, you know. But I think the American entrepreneur is stepping up. And what is this guy's name? His name is Zion. He's a futurist.
Yeah, it's like Z-E-I-H-A-N, you know, something like that. I think it's Peter Zion. He's, yeah, you can go. He's fascinating. Yeah, you know, I don't know. It's just the way he looks at how the infrastructure you have as a nation. So when he looks at our infrastructure, he looks at the amount of navigable waterways we have. And he will say that we have as many navigable waterways as the rest of the planet. And he just talks about how that it just makes everything cheap by moving stuff on water and moving things there. So for us, for example, you know, we're just a little bitty distillery. All our bottles, these bottles are coming from China. Well, right now, our bottle manufacturer is trying to get them someplace else because they're moving manufacturing out of China.
Is this guy the Accidental Superpower? Is that the name of his book?
Yeah, that's it. That's it.
Got it. I'll take a look at that. Well, sir, where can we buy Tobacco Barn, bourbon, whiskey, rum? Are you guys online or what's the website we can find you guys at?
We're on. It's www.tobaccobarndistillery.com. We're in Maryland. We have Total Wine in Maryland. We have two Total Wines in Maryland. It's mainly going to be in Maryland because we don't have a license outside of Maryland because we don't have enough to get outside Maryland yet. So it's going to be here. And if anybody's in the DC area, they can look, and we have an awesome tasting room. You can come down, have a cigar, try some bourbon on a pastoral Maryland farm. It's a pretty cool experience.
Fantastic. Well, we'll make sure we let all of our Maryland offices know about you guys. And I look forward to coming down to meet you and grabbing that cigar and some bourbon here in the not too distant future.
No, I appreciate it, Ryan. I'd be love to have you down here.
Admiral, thanks for coming on.
Got it. Mm-hmm. There's a great craft distillery up there in Brooklyn. It's called Kings County, if you don't know him. Colin Spalnick, he owns that. They just had their 10th anniversary. The cool thing about having a craft distillery, everybody helps you. So, I mean, I've reached out to him. He's helped out us a lot. Garrison Brothers in Texas, they're an awesome craft distillery. The Distillers Guild in Maryland and Virginia, we all help each other out. It's kind of a cool collaboration to work with. It's a great little community.
Well, and that's interesting. Is there a resource if people want to get involved and support local, you know, distillers? Is there a resource that they can go find, you know, Tobacco Barn or other of these smaller distillers that we can all, you know, as business owners, you know, buy from to give gifts to our clients for the Christmas season coming up?
Yeah, absolutely. So up in New York, you just go to the New York Distilling Guild that has it by region up there. There's a couple, three in you know, the Metro New York area. It'll talk about all the areas you can buy from, and that's a great way to do it. So, you know, so there's New York's probably in the top tier. New York, California, Texas, Washington State, they're at the top tier. Maryland's kind of at the second tier with Pennsylvania and Virginia and some of the other ones. We have about, you know, 30-ish, between 30 and 60, that's kind of the second tier. And then you get ones at, you know, California, Washington, they have 100. You know, over 100. And I think New York has 86 or 90.
Fantastic.
The thing is, well, sir, it's all about where it comes from. So you get the Finger Lakes region, that's going to taste different than what's downstate in New York. And so that's what people like trying. It's not all the same. It's not homogenized.
No, well, I definitely look forward to getting out to visit you guys in Maryland. And we have a lot of good offices in Maryland. So I'll make sure we put you in touch with them. And I can't wait to try it and do some industry survey with you.
Okay. Be great to have you, Ryan.
Thank you, sir. I'll talk to you soon.
Okay. Bye.
Thanks for watching Non-Beta Alpha. And before we go, please remember to like and subscribe on Apple Podcasts or our YouTube channel. This is Non-Beta Alpha. And now you know.
Get busy time! All
price references and market forecasts correspond to the date of this recording. This podcast should not be copied, distributed, published, or reproduced in whole or in part. The information contained in this podcast does not constitute research or recommendation from Non-Beta Alpha Inc., Wentworth Management Services, LLC, or any of their affiliates to the listener. Neither Non-Beta Alpha Inc., Wentworth Management Services, LLC, nor any of their affiliates make any representation or warranty as to the accuracy or completeness of the statements or any information contained in this podcast, and any liability, therefore, including in respect of direct, indirect, or consequential loss or damage, is expressly disclaimed. The views expressed in this podcast are not necessarily those of Non-Beta Alpha Inc. or Wentworth Management Services, LLC, and Non-Beta Alpha Inc. and Wentworth Management Services, LLC are not providing any financial, economic, legal, accounting, or tax advice or recommendations in this podcast. In addition, the receipt of this podcast by any listener is not to be taken as constituting the giving of investment advice by Non-Beta Alpha Inc. or Wentworth Management Services, LLC, to that listener, nor to constitute such person a client of any affiliate of Non-Beta Alpha Inc. or Wentworth Management Services, LLC. This does not constitute an offer to buy or sell any security. Investments in security may not be suitable for all investors. An investment of any security may involve risk and the potential loss of your initial investment. Investors should review all risk factors before investing. Investors should perform their own due diligence before considering any investment. Past performance is not indicative of future results. Investment products, insurance, and annuity products are not FDIC insured, not bank guaranteed, not insured by a federal government agency, may lose value.